Now let's go ahead and look at the efficiency effects of a positive externality. And again, we're going to think about what happens in our normal market equilibrium. And we're going to have some supply curve, and we're going to have some demand curve, and we're going to have our unregulated market equilibrium price, and we're going to have our unregulated market equilibrium quantity, P1 and Q1. And remember that when we have a positive externality, the marginal social benefit, the actual benefit from the consumption or production of the product, is the regular old private benefit that people get. And that's what builds the demand curve. That's what determines whether or not individuals and households are ready to buy the product. But there are then some external benefits. So let's again say the external benefit is, we're going to assume in this case that it's constant per unit. And we'll come to more complicated cases in a little bit. And let's say that it's about 4 squares. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And 1, 2, 3, 4. All right. So if we were to think about what curve would reflect the total marginal social benefit, it would be the marginal private benefit here plus this marginal external benefit of 4 squares. And we will challenge my art skills to see if I can do this. Okay, so we would have a curve like that that would reflect the marginal social benefit of producing this product. Now what we're going to see here is we're actually going to see some inefficiency in the market equilibrium. Because when we think about what the efficient quantity would be, if we think about, say, for instance, this unit of quantity right down here, here's the cost to produce that unit. How much of society's resources are used up when we produce that unit? Up here is the benefit. Benefit. Cost. So, if we created that unit, we would get this much gains from trade. Now, because some of the benefits are external, the private buyer doesn't have the incentive to demand that product. And the private buyer right here is only willing to offer a maximum of that price. And this seller has a minimum price to break even up there. So they're not willing to get together and make a trade voluntarily. But if we somehow were able to persuade them to do so, it would be overall a net benefit to society. And that's going to hold true for all these transactions up until this point here. So at this point here, the cost of production from the supply curve and the benefit of production as measured by the marginal social benefit are the same. So here is our efficient quantity. And to get there, the efficient price of the output would be something like that. So then how can we actually persuade or incentivize people to do so? Before we go there, just to remember, the market equilibrium is inefficient in this case. And in particular, the market underproduces, because notice that the market equilibrium quantity is less than the efficient quantity. So market underproduces the good associated with the positive externality. And I already talked about negative externalities a little bit in the very first video segment. But what are going to be examples of positive externalities? Positive externalities could be something like, well, painting my house. When I paint my house, I raise my neighbor's property values and I make life more pleasant for them. Or I move my Trans Am off the front lawn and raise their property values. Or it could be something like research and development. So when someone researches a new scientific idea or develops a new product, that may make knowledge available to other people, and it may inspire them to go out there and do something. So those are the most commonly cited sorts of things that we talk about with positive externalities. What are we going to do about this? Well, we can go ahead and think about Pigouvian subsidy. The typical policy response to a negative externality is to tax people to discourage them from undertaking the transaction. If we have a positive externality, we want to encourage people to undertake the transaction because they're not doing enough of it on their own. And in particular, if we have this nice constant marginal external benefit, the subsidy should be equal to the marginal external benefit. So this is going to be a subsidy that's actually going to increase economic efficiency. Of course, the downside of that is that we're going to have to get that tax revenue from somewhere. So tax revenue must come from somewhere. And, of course, our taxes create deadweight loss. So we would have sort of this tie between, or this tug of war between, on the one hand, we want to subsidize this activity to get to the efficient level of this activity. On the other hand, when we tax some other activity, we're creating deadweight loss in that market, unless, of course, we're taxing something that's a negative externality. Economists are, in general, a little bit wary of throwing out subsidies for alleged positive externalities because you can see how people are going to be very, very fond of making an argument that their particular industry generates a lot of positive externality and could they have their money now, please? So you want to be a little bit careful, and this also sort of comes back to that idea of we want to distinguish between the pecuniary indirect externalities that don't impair economic efficiency and the direct or technical externalities that do. In particular, you don't need to subsidize activities that have pecuniary externalities, nor do you need to tax them, to get to the efficient level, because those sorts of externalities don't impair economic efficiency. So that's going to go ahead and be another test that you would need your externalities to pass before you would want to go ahead and tax or subsidize them.